Want to thank the friends that are here today that come and support this family today. Of course, you know that he's my father-in-law, and I see our church members here, and I've had a good father-in-law that has just loved me, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that later on. But he's been there for me, and he's been there for my family and for my two boys. He's been right there with us. And so Clinton Pace has been more than I could ask for in a father-in-law. I just want to take a second and just share a man who's 87 years old when he passed away. He's had a full life, had a wonderful wife, wonderful children. And when I looked at this and began to see the family, I met some of the family before. I've met not all of them, but most of them. And, of course, he's preceded in death by his mother, Julie, and his father, Freeman. He had four sisters, Annie, Zelma, Alma, and Elizabeth. And that was his four sisters. And I think I only got to see two of those, if I'm not right. I'm looking at my wife here. But then he had two brothers, of course, Joe and Norman. He's also preceded in death, you know, by his wife, Lorraine, my mother-in-law, who passed away, actually, it's a lot less than 4 months ago, almost three full months. And so when I come here today, my heart is heavy for the two kids, Clint and Sherry. To lose two parents in such a short time is difficult to handle. And to go through that time because you've been with them all your life, and then just like that, they're out of your life. But the good news is they've been redeemed through the blood of the Lamb. And that's the great news, that we come with that security and to know that they're more alive today than ever. We have such a great privilege today because both his grandchildren wanted to say a few words. So I'm going to ask my youngest, who is Ethan, he's going to come at this time and just share a few words with you.
Thank you all for coming. I know it's really soon to the last one, but I just want to say a few words about my grandpa. First of all, I didn't know him as Clinton. I knew him as Pops. Me and my brother always knew him as that. So one thing is, Mimi was Zach's partner, but Pops was my partner. So one thing I've just been thinking about is, well, you know, Mimi and Pops are together right now, Zach. So we're going to have to start stepping up our game, okay? We got to start practicing. One thing also about Pops was I love to do was talk about football. The way you would hear Pops talk about football, you would think that they didn't like the Cowboys. He always called them the Dallas Cowgirls. But he was such a diehard fan that he was so critical of every move they made. But he was like that because he was really enthralled and he loved the team. And the thing about that is I saw that kind of action just the way he dealt with things. He was very, very particular, very precise. But he did that because he loved it. And it was good. And it's just amazing that me and Zach had two grandparents who loved us unconditionally. I'll just always have that and always cherish that. Another thing that I really liked about Pops was when me and Zach were really young, he had this polar bear, like kind of knick-knack. It's like a paperweight. So it always talked to us. Pops would have it, he'd be like, what, what's that? Okay, yeah, boys, well, he'd have it talk to us, and me and Zach were just, what is this? Okay, we would listen to the bear, we'd listen to the bear's stories through Pops and everything. And, you know, the other day I was at the house, and at his house, and I saw that bear, and you know, I was just watching it going, I really think it does speak, you know, I just watched it for a little bit because he was a little too precise on the things it'd say. It was just, Pops was just so easy to get along with. everything about it was just, he was so happy. Never really saw him ever get angry. Well, except at the Cowboys. That was the only thing. But I'm going to miss my grandparents. But the thing about missing them is I at least had that time. I had 27 years with my grandparents, and I'll always cherish that. I just want to thank everyone for coming. I love my family. Thank y'all. Thank y'all church members, too. And thank y'all.
Thank you, Ethan. My oldest is going to come, Zachary. And you come right on.
As my brother said, it's no secret that as young kids, we idolized my grandpa. And even as me and Ethan grew taller than him, we still looked up to him. But I mean, how couldn't you? Just anybody who talked to him, just you could just have a spark of life come off him. And people loved to clutch to that. When he talked to you, you felt important. And, you know, he had such great stories, too. And the older me and Ethan got, the more embellishments those stories got. But, you know, we didn't say nothing. We wanted to believe them as they were, and, you know, we're going to keep doing that. But more than the stories he told were the lessons we learned from watching him live. One of the best lessons I have from him is that there's value in everything if you apply it right. I remember being a little kid, and Pops was supervising some of the kids from the church, which probably wasn't a good idea to begin with, but he was supervising us, and we were looking for rocks. And I found this rock that I thought was like this perfect rock. And I said, I got a piece of petrified wood here. And some of the older kids were like, you're dumb. That's not a piece of petrified wood. That's an ugly rock. But Pops was there, and he said, man, I wish I had that rock. I said, really? What? He's like, would you give me that rock? I was like, yeah. He said, man, this is one of the finest rocks I've ever seen. And just him saying that, just, it built confidence up on me. And even as I got a little bit older, Pops loved watching me and my brother play baseball games. And once my parents went out of town and we were left with the grand folks, and Pops asked me, what time's practice? I said, 6 o'clock. He had me out at practice at 5 o'clock, an hour early to practice. And I said, Pops, the practice is not for an hour. He's like, yeah, but your coach, he's going to know you want to play. He's going to know that you respect the team good enough not to be late. Because if you're early, you're on time. And that stuck with me even today. I tell you, there's not one meeting in my personal adult life that I've ever been late to. I'm even always there before my boss, and my boss says, Seaver, I can always count on you to make these meetings on time. And I say, I learned that from my grandpa. And, you know, so he just taught me, like Ethan said, to pay attention to detail, to respect what you do, to be on time. But he also taught me another lesson. It's one of my favorite personal stories that I don't really know if I've really ever told anyone about this. But as I said, me and Ethan love playing baseball. And we were watching Ethan play a Little League game. And this was in Brenham. And, you know, Brenham, it was kind of a poor Little League team. They didn't have a bunch of money. But me and my grandpa, we would always sit kind of behind the dugout. And the fence was a tall fence, and it had these nets that came across it to help protect people from foul balls. So I remember my brother hit a foul ball. And like I said, this community was kind of poor, so they wouldn't start the game until you threw the foul ball back. So I always wanted to run down, track down the balls, and throw them back. So sure enough, this foul ball came down. I picked it up, and I've been practicing my throw all year. And I threw the ball, and it slipped. And I hit the net of that, the net of the Little League fence, and the crowd goes, boo, learn how to throw. And as a little kid, you can't take embarrassment like that. I was, like, so embarrassed. And I didn't see, though, that the crowd really couldn't see if it was me or my pops who had thrown the ball. He picked up the ball and said, I'm sorry, I'm just an old man. I'm gonna let my grandson throw it again. And I looked at him, I said, no. And he said, throw it. The worst they can do is boo you. And I threw it just perfectly, and it went out there, and the guy even said, yeah, at least your grandson can throw. But I always thought about that because, you know, he was okay for putting himself on the line for you, any type of embarrassment or everything. So that's the last lesson, you know. The worst people can do is boo you. So the last time I seen him was a few months ago, and I was talking to him, and he said, you remember that rock I gave you? I said, no. And sure enough, he still had that rock I gave him as a kid. And he had wrote on it, January 31st, 1996. He still valued what I gave him, even to that day. Just an ugly rock, but it meant something to him. Yeah. And I know my pops gave me this rock. I know I gave him this rock to keep, but I think I'm going to take it back and just let it remind me of the lessons that he taught me. And pops, if people don't like that, the worst they can do is boo us.
Amen.
I love you, pops. I'm going to miss you.
I know one thing. I'm humbled today, pops, because I thought I taught my kids everything. Now I found out I didn't teach him anything. Wow. We have right now his son, Dr. Clinton Pace. And I'm going to ask, Dr. Pace, would you come at this time?
Y'all honor us, our family. Excuse me. In the memory of my dad, I've known CJ for 60 years, and a lot of y'all, I know you knew him as he was older, as an adult. But how you knew him was how he was his whole life. It has to do with character, not what he did, but what he believed. The last time that I got to see him was on Christmas, and it was before my mother's passing, and we stayed in the house, and he had his door open a crack when I went to the bathroom, and I came back, and I heard him as an 86-year-old man on his knees praying out loud. That's what he did. And I guess the hard thing for me is what he gave me. I grew up, and I can tell you there was never a single time in my whole life that I didn't know that he loved me with all his heart. Can you imagine what that does to a kid? My rebellious teenage years, my getting short with him, I never once suspected that I didn't mean the world to him. And that's what he gave me. And it wasn't lip service. He meant it. And that was because he was a godly man. It was in his core, and you could not separate what he was from what he believed. It reminds me of the story, a story that Jesus told about a father and his two sons. And it's referred to as the prodigal son. But it's really about the father, and it should be called the prodigal father. Prodigal is not a word that's used, except how I've ever heard it is in the context of that story. And it means wasteful or recklessly extravagant. And it refers to the blowing of the early inheritance that the early son beseeched from his father, that he granted him. But another meaning of the word is lavishly abundant and profuse. And that's how my father's love was for me. And I will miss him horribly, because he was an anchor in my life. In the last 4 months, while I was at home, I saw some medical records that he had from 17 years ago. And his lung tests were so bad that he wouldn't be expected to live 5 years based on those lung tests. That was in 2003. He was a fighter. And I did want to tell one story that he taught me, and that was that our lawnmower broke when I was a child. And he borrowed the neighbor's. And after he cut the grass, he washed it and wiped it down, filled it full of gas and oil. And he said, whenever you borrow something from somebody, you give it back to them in better shape than it was when you got it. That's what he believed. He was a humble man. And they talk about heaven on earth and Garden of Eden. This is just earth on earth. And he's in a better place now, and he's finally met his rest. He's been suffering for many months, very difficult times, and he never got over the passing of my mother. She was the love of his life, and he took care of her. And when they put her in the nursing facility, it was taking three people to do what he had been doing, just to get her to the bathroom every night. So I thank God that I was able to be raised by that man.
could we just take just a moment and go to the Lord in prayer at this time? Dear Father, we thank you so much for your presence in this place today. And Jesus, we just lift you up, your Lord of our lives, your Lord of this place. And Father, we recognize you and your goodness and your grace. And Father, we know that all things come from you. And Father, your timing is always very perfect. So God, I ask you to meet with these two kids, with Sherry and Clint, God, just to be their strength and their stronghold right now. And Father, we thank you for being able to be a part of, I can't help but want to call him Pops, my father-in-law, Mr. Pace, just a part of his life and his wife's life, Lorraine. God, we pray that you would help us right now to comfort us through your word. For it's in Jesus we pray. Amen. It was January 30th of this year that we had there at the church house your mother's services. She had passed, and I know how hard it was to take her to the nursing facility. We'd always tried our best to take care of family and home, and it got to be impossible to do so. And I see it a lot as a pastor, and I understand it. And I know that in sometimes there's guilt that we feel like we didn't do enough. But I want you to know these two were loved and cared for, and you did everything you could. I watched Pops, and I thought about it, how we're never ready. Even though we prepare ourselves, we're never ready for someone we love so much to pass and to die. We knew it was coming. We had planned for it, but it was not easy. And it hasn't been easy. And I think it's hard to grasp the fact that Mom and Dad are not here now. Just between my wife and I, it's hard for me to realize that my mother and father-in-law, who I've got to live around closely for 18 years being right there with them down the road, it's been difficult now to think that they're not there. I think one of the great things is that my father-in-law, one thing his son didn't say, he was hard-headed. He wanted to be in that house. He did not want to leave his home. And I respect that because I'm going to be the same way, I think. And he wanted to stay in that house. And so we did everything we could to see that he did. And he stayed there and he died in his home. Some people have the opportunity to have somebody there at their last breath or be in a care facility with nurses around. But my Pops, wanting to live in his house, he did it his way. That's the way he did it. And I tell you what a blessing. What a blessing to have that. To the last moment to be in your home and then to pass. And I want you kids to know this. Your daddy, when I walked up there and found him, I knew. Sherry and I knew that night. I said, I'm headed over there. Your dad was peaceful. And as you know, we hear these stories, they look so peaceful and all that. You know, that's not what I'm talking about here. It was sudden. It happened suddenly. And he just had a look. And I knelt down there with your dad. And I said to him, Pops, I love you. Enjoy heaven. Now, he wasn't paying attention to me. He's with the Lord. Presence of the Lord. He has no more place here. But I needed that. And I want you to know that everything is okay because he did not die alone. Jesus was right there with him when he passed on. And he's right there with him right now. In Psalms 103, verse 15, it says this. As for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field. The winds blow over it and it's gone. And the place is remembered. It has remembered it no more. Now, that verse, I'm going to tell you, sounds fatalistic. But we realize that life is quick and it passes fast. And I think the older I get now, all of a sudden I begin to be able to see the end closer than the beginning of my life. And it causes me to take a picture of my life and to say, what do I want the rest of my life to be? When I think of my father-in-law, I think the good news is that God says in Hebrews 13:5, he says, but I shall not forget, I remember you. God will remember you. He remembers his children. So I wrote down just a few things for you today. And it's this, because I needed them, that the scripture reminds us that we're all going to say goodbye to this world. Every one of us, if God tarries, we're going to say goodbye to this world. And in doing so, there comes this time of sadness. And I take the passage of scripture that comes out of Acts chapter 20 and verse 36. And I want to start there. Paul is in his third missionary journey. And Paul is leaving the church there in the book of Acts. He's leaving them for the last time. He's not going to see them anymore. And he says these words. And when he had said these things, that is to bless those who are poor, take care of those who labor in the Lord, he said this, these things. He knelt down and he prayed with them all. Then they all wept freely and fell on Paul's neck and kissed him, sad most of all because of the words that he spoke, that they would see his face no more. And they accompanied him all the way to the ship. Understand what he was talking about, that on this earth they were not going to see him anymore. And I'm going to tell you, the only way you'll see him again is if you put your faith in Jesus Christ. That's the only way. The Bible tells us that. It's not because the Baptist preacher says so, the Bible says so. I think if there was no sadness here today, it'd be because there wasn't any love here today. But there's sadness because there was deep love. And deep love is the pain you pay is sadness for loving somebody so much. I remember the first time I met my mother and father-in-law. I'm not going to talk about it all. I went into their home, and I was nervous a little bit. And I walk in there, and my father-in-law is a talker. Believe it or not, he's a salesperson. Let me tell you, he could sell you oceanfront property in Arizona, I promise you. But he loved to talk, but he was quiet. So I didn't know how to take him because my future wife, my fiance, was telling me how he was a talker. My mother-in-law, though, is the one that was talking. My mother-in-law never liked me until I gave her grandkids. And when I gave her grandkids, she liked me from then on. And I always used them against her, okay? That was my mother. But my father-in-law came around pretty well. It happened again on last Wednesday. I had been over there mowing the grass and stuff. Clint, I want you to know I was sitting. He was leaned up. He could hardly breathe. He was just leaned over. He said, thank you. Thank you. And I said, oh, Pops, love you. And he said those famous words. He says, I just want you to know you're my most favorite son-in-law of all. I'm his only son-in-law. But he always held that over me, you know. I was his favorite son-in-law. We got along together. And one of my great memories of my father-in-law was this. And I have to tell from my experience, because I don't know a lot of the experience of y'all growing up with Dad, but I know the experience I had. He loved to go fishing, but it had to be crappie fishing. And the boys will remember this. Out in the boat, they were little knotheads in that boat. I mean, they were the ones who would take the minnows and put on the hook, and they would kiss the minnows. In fact, I had one of my kids one day ate a minnow just to prove a point. Just sucked it right on down. I don't think I taught them that, but that was one of them educational times. But my father-in-law was sitting up there, and he was caught a crappie. We were catching crappie off a brush pile, and the boys remember, Pops swung his bait up to me, and I reached down in the bucket and got a minnow, and I did this and threw it over in the water. And we were all catching fish, and I put it right up next to him, caught a big old crappie, put it in the boat. And Pops raised up. He says, well, it's got my bait already. I said, well, hand it here. He handed it here, and I put my hand in the bucket and did that, threw it back in the water. And about the fourth time, he's just disgusted. We were all catching the crappie. They were loaded on that brush pile. He throws it over to me again. I reach in the bucket. I do that, and he throws over there, and he goes, wait a minute. And he raised it up, and I had been putting a minnow on his hook. I'd just been doing that and throwing it in the water. He said, I'm watching you now from now on the rest of your life. I'm watching you. He said, what a scoundrel. And you're a Baptist preacher. And it was the biggest time. And just being at those times, I remember with my father-in-law, was just a lot of fun, a lot of joy. Your dad, I commend him so much to watch him, how he took care of his wife. He became a caregiver for, my goodness, a year. Really, 6 to 8 months was very intense. And I watched my father-in-law at the end of his rope or string. I always say string, but he would, those few months before we had to put my mother-in-law in the care facility, he was taking care of her, getting her up during the night, 3-4 times a night to go to the bathroom. He's never sleep deprived, hung, just trying to get food together and going over there and seeing it and us saying, Pops, tell us what you want us to do. We'll do it. We'll try to help you. You know, he bound and determined he was going to be that caregiver. And we watched him come to a place where we just felt like it was dangerous for him. You know, he was just at the end, but he did it to the best he could to the end, because that was his wife. And it was that commitment of love. He loved her, but it's the commitment. And that's what I always tell people. Love doesn't keep you together. A commitment to the Lord keeps you together. And love grows. That's what the Bible teaches. In the Bible it says, and they married them and they loved them. It doesn't say they loved them and married them. It says they married them, and then they spent the rest of their life loving them. That was the commitment that I saw in my father-in-law. Again, I thought of the thing, when is a person ready to die? Not everybody's ready to die. My father-in-law was a deacon for over 40 years, deacon at Calvary Baptist. But that didn't make him ready to die. He was a member of a church, one church, for many, many years, and then Calvary's a member of Calvary. And I was impressed that he became a member of his son-in-law's church that I pastored. I was hoping that was because he liked me. He liked my preaching. But I want you to know something. My father-in-law would always come in, sit at the back pew, like some of my members, sat on the very back row with his sunglasses on. I'd preach my heart out, and I still don't know if he ever heard a sermon because I never could see his eyes. He had his sunglasses on. Why he did that, I don't know. And sometimes he'd be chewing that gum. That was my pops. That was him. But there'd be times he said, I really like what you said in that sermon. So he listened to something. And I was always glad to hear it. He was a greeter. And here at Calvary, you'd come in the children's area, he was always back there greeting. He was a talker. He loved to be talking with people. He was a greeter at Walmart for a while. And he knew everybody. People loved my father-in-law at Walmart where they would come through. But that didn't make him a Christian. So I wrote down this, not until you know and acknowledge Christ as your Savior are you ready. You know, I've watched those who have come to an open casket, and all they see at an open casket is a hopeless end. But as believers, we come to this open casket, and I see an endless hope. Because hope is for sure. It's not just I hope things get better. It is a sure thing in the Bible. It's a hope that is sure. Because it was founded upon the rock of the blood of Jesus Christ. It makes the difference. when I walked into that house the other day, the thought that went through my mind is that so many people think we're in the land of the living, headed to the land of the dying. But I'm going to assure you we're not. We're in the land of the dying, headed to the land of the living. And my father-in-law today has made it to the land of the living. Because this is just that place for eternity. And when this is over, eternity comes. And we must know what makes it okay in eternity, and that's Jesus. So to my father-in-law, been so privileged. I brought my mother-in-law's bulletin, such a pretty lady. I'm going to have her bulletin and my father-in-law's bulletin together, and I'm going to start a brand new file. I've stood behind this place so many times, I don't know how many. But I'm going to tell you, it's been difficult for my mother-in-law and my father-in-law to stand here. I'm so glad that my father-in-law got to see his Creator. Because to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. In the Bible it says the bosom of Abraham, the presence of God is what that is. He's had a good journey. But I walk away from here not sad. Yeah, I miss my father-in-law, and I know you two kids do. Family does. We're going to miss him. But we're going to keep them alive. We're not going to forget. The thing that we do is make sure we go to meet their same Jesus one day. And we get there, and it's by Christ. We're going to go to the graveside in just a moment. And as we do, let's just be reminded that that's not a resting place. It's just a resting place for the great shell, the great body that our loved ones lived in. Brother Pace, this is just his shell. And I thank God for it. And so at that graveside, that's just his shell. But there's coming a day. I don't know how God's going to do it. But he's God, so I'll let him figure that out, okay? That spirit's going to get back in there. Gives us a sign of that spiritual body right there. And the Bible says, and so we shall forever be with the Lord. Amen and amen. Let's just pray again. Let's just bow our heads just a moment. Dear Father, I thank you for the song Brother Nathan's going to sing. It's such a powerful song. And I'm so thankful that I've had such wonderful privilege to speak of a God who loves us. And God, to be able to stand here with a sadness but yet a peace in my heart, to know that everything's okay. And to know that you're the strength of my wife and my brother-in-law, that you lift them up in this time, God, because nothing that I could say could, but God, you can. And so, Father, in your presence right now, we just lift you up in this. And I thank you that your timing has been perfect. And God, we accept it. And God, we move on with joy in our heart to know that, God, you're in control. So thank you, God, that I don't have to take control of this, but, God, you already have it. That, God, you've got my back. And, Jesus, I love you. For it's in Christ we do pray. Amen. You know, I want to say one other thing. My father-in-law, when I got here today, he was already here. When he went to a job, just as you said, he was there an hour early. The last time, get this, the last time he was at church, I drove up to the church at about 15 till 7, and my father-in-law was sitting in the back of the church in his truck. He was always early. Some of you know that. He beat us to heaven, too. Can you believe it? You know, he was always early. Amen. God bless you, Brother Nathan.